It's going to be Psalms 32. I think it's verses 1 through 6, if I'm not mistaken. That's how kind of as far as I really wanted to go. Okay, so it starts out as, it says, blessed is, of course, this is David. Blessed is he whose transgression is forgiven, whose sin is covered. Blessed the man to whom the Lord does not impute iniquity, and in whose spirit there is no deceit. When I kept silent, my bones grew old through my groaning all the day long. For day and night, your hand was heavy upon me. My vitality was turned into the drought of summer. I acknowledged my sin to you, and my iniquity I have not hidden. I said, I will confess my transgression to the Lord, and you forgave the iniquity of my sin. Like I said, I was just going to read some of it. And so we'll go ahead and pray. God, thank you for this evening. We thank you for this wonderful day that you have provided to us, Father, in this special week that we celebrate your Passover in the salvation and the saving and the sanctification of your children, Father. And so we ask, God, that you be with us tonight, as the song says, just being in your presence right now, Father, and allowing your word to speak and helping me to remove myself and my own personal, whatever my own personal words may be, let them be in line with whatever you have for us in growing us as men, Father, in this place and in our lives outside of this place. And as we touch those people, God, that you put in our midst. And so we ask again that you just allow us to just ingrain ourselves, God, immerse ourselves in your word in these verses tonight. I ask that each man here be blessed and that same spirit, Father, would carry over into the women's study as they learn to just soak you up as well and allow your spirit to fill them afresh, Father, as they go through the rest of their day or the rest of their week. And just give them strength to endure whatever they may encounter, as these men as well. So at this moment right now, God, I pray for peace in their hearts, peace in their minds, that they can be able to just listen to you just for a brief moment. And we can just all just listen to what you have to say to us and learn something from you. So in your name we pray, Father. In Jesus' name, everybody say, amen. So we're going to be in Joshua 7 again. And so we're going into Joshua 7. And so from the previous chapter, they were speaking of Rahab. You can cut this off if you don't mind. Yeah. And so we have Rahab. They have the victory at Jericho. I don't want it on and off right now. Okay. Yeah. And we'll change it back to the PowerPoint a little bit. And so Joshua 7, in the previous chapter, again, they were victorious in the taking of Jericho and rescuing, or you see the salvation of God going in and taking out a remnant, I guess you could call it, Rahab and her family, and destroying the rest of the lot. I think Tom taught on Rahab being one of the most important, if not one of the most important people in the lineage of Christ, because she is the grandmother. And so you see God moving in that perspective. I think in this chapter, what we see here is the Lord always wanting to be in a relationship with his people. And that's what kind of the synopsis of the gospel, if you want to call it that, of Joshua being God wanting to be in a relationship and showing his redemptive power through just common, everyday people. People who are coming out of some things, some bad habits, and worshiping idols and things like that, and doing a great work in them, but also, you know, having them go through lots of trials too. You know, there's not just victory, you know, all the time. There's victory is the end. You know, I was watching, I don't know if you guys ever saw this show, Naked and Afraid. This young lady had never had any wilderness experience, and she was talking to her dad, and her dad says, if you just keep your eyes focused at the end of the tunnel and see that light, say, you'll make it through anything. And so her partner, which was a male, bailed out on her about 3 days in. So she had to do 21 days. So she did the remaining days on her own. And as I was watching that show, that's kind of what that stuck out in my mind about what she said. And it's kind of the same thing here, you know, keeping our eyes. God has a plan no matter what we think. You know, we just have to keep our eyes focused on the light, which is Him. And we're going to go through some tough taints, some tough things, and we're going to make some bad decisions. We're going to miss some stuff, but yet, you know, the victory is coming, you know. And so that's why I wanted to read that scripture in the beginning, because, you know, is that we have to always remember that, you know, as we go through those things, and there are going to be some victories, there are also going to be some failures along the way. And then we have to remember to always ask for forgiveness as we keep moving. You know, you can pray while you're walking, and ask for forgiveness as you continue to move forward. And you'll see this in Joshua 7. And so with that, let's go to Joshua 7, verse 1. Because, you know, in chapter 8, whoever's teaching that chapter, you'll see the victory at Ai, right? They finally get the victory, but they have to go through some stuff before they actually get to the victory or any other victories. And so we'll see this change here. It's kind of like, you know, you up on the mountaintop, and then all of a sudden, bam, you know, you hit that gravel, man. You realize that gravel ain't moving. You got up, man, and you got scars all over the place, man. You know, but there's always some neosporin in there somewhere. And you can clean yourself up, man, and keep it moving. If I can get to my spot. Where's my... Did the book of Joshua leave my Bible? It's in the front half. Wait a minute. Where did it go? That's why I got these cheat tabs in here. Goodness gracious. Oh, man. I must have been gotten nervous. There it is. All right. So, Joshua 7, verse 1. And in my book, it has the defeat of Ai, but that's later. So it says, but the children of Israel committed a trespass regarding the accursed thing, for Achan, the son of Carmi, the son of Zabdi, and the son of Zerah of the tribe of Judah, took of the accursed things. So the anger of the Lord burned against the children of Israel. So in this first chapter, or not the first chapter, but the first verse, it seems to me that it would go along with the previous chapter 6. Because in verse 19, we see here it says, but all silver and gold and vessels of the bronze and iron are consecrated to the Lord. They shall come into the treasury of the Lord. So this commandment or this rule had already been set. And so before they went in to take Jericho, they already knew, you know, that this stuff was consecrated already to the Lord. And then it says, they only the silver and gold and the vessels of the bronze and iron they put into the treasury of the house of the Lord. And that's in later on down in verse 24. So they was already set to for a designated place. And then whatever they didn't take, they set up, right? And so, in my view, it just seems like the person who is extrapolating from what happened in this instance, it was already known that Achan had already taken this stuff, right? And I say that this way because there is no definitive author of the book of Joshua, right? Joshua didn't write it. So it's basically a narrative of what happened. And just like as I was looking at that, I said, I thought Joshua wrote it, you know. But in some of the study Bibles say that there is no definitive author of the book of Joshua. And as I sat there and I thought about that, I thought, wow, I've always learned that the book of Joshua and the example that we see of Joshua is also a type of Christ, you know, being displayed here, because he's like, again, he's having this relationship with his people, and you see the salvation of the Lord coming too. And so and I thought about that. I said, wow, you know, that's amazing. I said, what other books? And then I thought about it. I said, as I was reading in my devotion about the priesthood and Melchizedek, you know, and in the book of Hebrews, you know, there's no definitive author of that either, you know, but still we're talking about a Christophany of Christ, you know, being present, you know. And so I said, wow, that's amazing. But not that it's new. Somebody else may have already known that. It just kind of dawned on me, you know. But I thought that was interesting that these two books, that they would mention that these two books didn't have a definitive author. I think a lot of people are leaning towards Paul writing the book of Hebrews. But even Pastor David, you know, claims that he's not sure, but he leans towards Paul writing it. I do too, and I'll still lean toward Joshua writing the book of Joshua, but you know, it's safe for me, but it's still a narrative and a narrative of, or an extrapolation from the things that actually happened. But anyway, that being said, in the first chapter, or the first verse, they knew, I guess somehow somebody knew that this gold had already been taken and laid aside for themselves or for this family. And so with that, you know, first thing we talk about is leadership, you know. And I think that one of my things that I like to say sometimes that leadership is responsible for a lot of stuff, right? But then also, you know, I don't think you can be accountable for all things, because the Bible tells us too that, you know, people make decisions. They make their own decisions, you know. And so in this instance, you know, in our next verse, right, in verse 2, we see that we see Joshua in action. He says, now Joshua sent men from Jericho to Ai, which is beside Beth Aven, right, on the east side of Bethel, and spoke to them, saying, go up and spy out the country. So the men went up and spied out Ai. So again, the first verse is showing us that these men had already taken this this silver and gold. And so here if you may not see it this way, that Joshua is still in Jericho fighting a battle while he's sending other men out to go and spy out the next battle. And that's like leaders, you know, not only are we encompassed with our current battle and our current situation, we're also encompassed with what's next, you know. And we have to have, as we say here, we have to have men who are dependable, you know, that we can entrust to bring us back good information. And I don't think these men that Joshua sent out were bad men. I just think that in the heat of the battle, you know, there may have been some detail that would have been missed. And sometimes we can underestimate our enemy. And in my notes, you know, I've had a long time to really read this and kind of live life and kind of do my own thing and kind of just look at, kind of trying to figure this out, which is a good thing. You know, and as men, I kind of lost my train of thought. You know, as like, and so here is Joshua in the midst of this battle and sending out these men. And like I said, he's in the midst of a battle. And so you don't always think of everything. You can't think of everything. And you entrust to these men to do something that is important. And while he's fighting, right, this battle, he can't be responsible for the behavior, or he should be responsible for the behavior of all the people. But then also people had to be responsible for their own actions. And this is what this actually boils down to. And because later on in the chapter, you see that it was the family who actually was punished, but the whole clan paid the price. It was what they call a communal responsibility. And that's where we are, right? We're a church body, and we say it here all the time, you know, iron sharpens iron, and so we have to be responsible for one another. We can't say, well, you know, can you trust people? Sure. But can you also know that somebody might step out of bounds? Of course. Of course. Somebody's going to. I mean, that's a good leadership thing to know. And I think the word for that is, no matter what happens as a leader, you're still ultimately responsible for what happens, right? That's always the truth. You're always responsible. You may not know how it got that way, but you're ultimately responsible. And if you have men who are responsible for the task, and they have men that they've assigned to the task, you know, they can report back to you, but the final result is still yours, right, as a leader. So you never push blame off on anybody else. This is a good book on leadership, and if you kind of look at it that way. So I've covered that part. And so again, this would be, so, and then as I read through that, you know, I begin to ask myself, you know, So the men that were entrusted with this mission, again, as I mentioned in the beginning, I'm not sure if the men that he sent out knew that these people had already stolen this stuff and they had taken pride in winning the battle at Jericho. And they just thought, hey, you know, we're just going to keep right on rolling through the next enemy, you know, and we're going to get some more. I don't know. It doesn't say that, you know. Because, you know, when you win one victory, you think you got an automatic bid for the next one, you know, and you can just keep on, I don't know, stealing as you go. But we see here that in verse 3, it says, and they returned to Joshua and they said to him, do not let all the people go up, but let about 2,000 or 3,000 men go up and attack Ai. So they had already, in their own eyes, decided that, you know, the enemy in Ai wasn't that great, right? Or it wasn't that big of a foe. But as I was looking at this and reading it and having time to look at it, you know, the enemy wasn't really Ai, right? The enemy was in the camp. You know, the enemy is right here, man. The enemy is right amongst you. The enemy is your, I wouldn't want to say your brothers, but in this case, it was their brothers and sisters, you know. They were just doing whatever. I mean, we all got brothers and sisters we had to fight it with, right? And so they can hold us back from victory. Is that amazing? I didn't even write that down. Is that a word from the Lord? I don't know. But they can't hold us back. I was reading one of my friends last night, man. Good friend of mine was saying something. I saw a video a long time ago. And I'm trying to make this so you don't. Anyway, but had never heard anything about why. And just kind of just we're still friends and everything, but you know, finally said some stuff about the church, right? I kind of looked at it, you know. I said, well, you know, yeah, true, maybe, but you know, If my thing is this, if you don't agree with something that's going on, right, and you want to make a difference, and you feel like a difference needs to be made, then you have to intervene, right? And what does that look like? Sometimes that means confronting people, right? That means confronting them until you get your point across, not physically, but you have to continually be up front, right? And, or just stand your ground, you know, and hold firm to what you believe. And in this instance, you know, these people, you know, they definitely saw these folks take this silver. They saw it. They stood right by and let it happen. And yet you have people in the end who die. And so that's the same thing with this brother, you know. We stood by and watched this happen, and then we let him die. You know, and so if you see something that's not right, don't just stand by and let it happen, right? I think that's a good lesson. A person may be able to defend themselves, but yet if you know that there's something going on that's wrong, offer. You may not have to offer any help to this person or this group in particular, but if you know someone in leadership, say something about it. You know, don't just, you know, I think a lot of times, man, around here, you know, it could be something wrong, and you know it's wrong, yet you feel that, you know, your voice won't be heard if you say something about it, you know. And if that's the case, if you feel that way, you know, please, you know, let somebody know you feel that way. You know, if you feel like your voice here at the Bridge is drowned out, you know, by those sorts of things, and that the leadership or the pastor, Pastor David or Pastor Nick or Pastor Harry or Pastor Tom or Frank, any of those guys are too busy to listen to you, say something. Don't just say, you know, hey, man, you know, I know they're busy. They ain't got time to talk to me. Make them stop and have time to talk. That's for real. Because otherwise, they just going to go on doing what they're doing. They ain't going to think nothing's wrong. Because they don't know. You know, just like being married or having a wife. You know, I tell my wife all the time, I'm sorry, I didn't read that. I didn't hear you say that last night. I didn't. How do you expect me to know that? You didn't tell me. I don't read your mind. I'm not a mind reader. You know, so, you know, well, you should have known. No, how I should have known? I shouldn't have known that. How would I know that? You know, I joke with her all the time. Come on, man. She tell me, you thought you told me that, but you didn't really tell me that. Well, I'm sorry. No, I didn't tell you. I thought I told you. We've been living together for so long. I think I tell you. I really don't tell you. You know, so it goes both ways, you know. So, but voice your opinion, man. You know, it's important. It's important that you voice your opinion. And if, you know, I think small groups are good, but I think that there are some things, especially when it comes to leadership, that you shouldn't say in small groups. If you feel that strongly about it, then you should bring it to the leadership, seriously. Because when you bring it to those small, I'm not trying to get off topic. I just seen it happen. When you get in those small groups, man, and you get to gossiping with each other about a bunch of stuff, man, you can just turn it into a big old corn boil, man. And before you know it, everybody eating crawfish and salt dogs, man, and going down the road, you know, and then y'all have your own little party and nobody knows what happened. You know, now you're out here in the middle of the street lost, and then 10 years later you come back to the bridge in the front door. Don't do it to yourself. I mean, you know, just go ahead and be upfront about whatever you feel, you know, why you're here. And again, we're going to get to what it is to be a man here in a minute. So I'm going to keep reading, man. I don't want to get off on topic. So in verse 4 says, so about 3,000 men went up there from the people, but they fled before the men of Ai. And the men of Ai struck down about 36 men, for they chased them from before the gate as far as Sherbarim and struck them down on the descent. Therefore the hearts of the people melted and became like water. Then Joshua tore his clothes and fell down to the earth on his face before the ark of the Lord until evening. And he and the elders of Israel, and they put dust on their heads. In verse 7, and Joshua said, alas, Lord God, why have you brought this people over the Jordan at all to deliver us into the hand of the Ammonites, to destroy us? Oh, that we had been content and dwelt on the other side of the Jordan. Oh God, what shall I say when Israel turns its back before its enemies? Okay. So they got whooped. They're running home with their tail between their legs, right? And their leader is unaware of the enemy in the camp. And the men people have lost their lives. And again, back to verse 1, the people who know that this is going on haven't told the leader. They have never told him what happened. Maybe they don't think that the sins of the people is going to come back and haunt the whole tribe. I don't know. You know, they never told him. They just allowed him to go out there, and they allowed these men to be destroyed, or these supposed to be destroyed. They never said a word. They just kept right on plugging along. You know, that's what I'm saying. You know, you can be high one moment, right? You got the Lord riding with you, and you got the leader, he's still doing his thing. But then this gap, man, you know, these people, they just, boom, fell off, boom. They're trying to come back up, and they can't get back up the top of this hill because they did something down here. It's like all of us. We out here doing this, man, when, you know, God is still on this plane. He's moving right along. We down here digging in the dirt, you know, playing tiddlywinks when we should be paying attention. And so here's the leader, you know, praying all the day, praying until the evening at the foot of the cross, right, or at the foot of the altar, wondering what's wrong. And we should have stayed where we were. Have you brought us out here
to kill us? We've heard this several times, right?
Have you brought us out here to let us die? And what will the enemy say now that we have been defeated?
Remember in the previous chapters, you know, people at Jericho had already knew they were coming. And they knew, oh man, we can see this bloom cloud way in the distance. We know you guys are powerful, but now you've been defeated. What will the enemy say now? You're not as strong as you think you are, right?
We can get you. We can take you out, man. We can take these guys out, man. Same thing with our walk with Christ. The minute that we disobey, or the minute that we, you know, turn loose or ask God to turn us loose and let us go on our own, the enemy is standing there waiting to devour.
And I think, again, it's allowed to happen
so that we don't take our eyes off of the light at the end of the tunnel. Right? We got to always keep our eyes on the Lord. And then it's on verse 8 or on verse 9. For the Canaanites and all the inhabitants of the land will hear it and surround us and cut us and cut off our name from the earth. So they know that they're just, it's all over, man. Everything's over, man. God, oh, we're wiped out. We're done. I got to give up now. I got to go back home and soak my wounds and not come back out for a month. Then what will you do for your great name? You know, God, if we lose, who are you going to be? Yeah, man, you're going to be wiped out too, you know. And then, verse 10, so the Lord said to Joshua, get up. Why do you lie thus on your face, right?
Out there crying. Is that what we do, right? Fall down flat on the, I can count the times I fell on my face in my house. Bloof.
Oh, I'm weak. What am I going to do? You know? What happened, Lord? Oh, God says, get up. We got something to do. God says that Israel has sinned, and they have also transgressed my covenant, which I commanded them. For they have taken some of the accursed things and have both stolen and deceived, and they have also put it among their own stuff. Therefore, the children of Israel should not stand before their enemies, but turned their backs before their enemies, because they have become doomed to destruction. Neither will I be with you anymore unless you destroy the accursed from among you. So in verse 11, Israel has sinned and they have also transgressed my covenant, which I commanded them, for they have even taken some of the accursed things and have both stolen and deceived, and they have also put it among their own stuff. So again, that's, here we go, you know, picking up things along the way. We always want to add to what God has already done for us. We can think we can just keep some stuff, you know, and keep it amongst our stuff, you know, and then we can just keep on walking with the Lord. I had some CDs in my garage, and I don't know, I've been having these for like 10 years, I think. And that tape on? And so I was in the garage. It was down in the corner there. See where this is going? And so my wife said, what's that box? I said, this is some old CDs, you know. And so immediately I picked it up, you know, went through it and threw it in the trash. I've been wanting to throw it away for a long time. But I kept some, you know, some old jazz CDs, some John Coltrane, some Miles Davis and stuff like that. I like a lot of jazz music. And so I kept some of that stuff. And but the example being, you know, just keeping old stuff, you know, and still trying to walk with the Lord, you know, not wanting to let those things go. It's nothing wrong with music. I just like music. But I think there's also some music that you shouldn't be listening to, you know, something you shouldn't listen to. You pick out what it is you don't need to be listening to. I'll figure out what it is I don't need to be listening to. But we all know what it is, right?
But yeah, I mean, so, but the idea being like the children of Israel here, now again, they came out of this society where, you know, they had all, they worshiped all of this stuff, right? And we all know that, you know, stuff doesn't get you anywhere. It's just stuff. It's just stuff. And they were making idols out of anything, and they were praying to anything. And so they decided to want to take that stuff with them, you know. Silver and gold was one of those things that they idolized, you know. They, you know, what good would silver and gold do you buried in the dirt? It's buried in the dirt. It's under it's under blankets. It's like having $1 million. People say, I got $1 million. What are you doing with $1 million? Oh, it's over there in the corner. That's good. It's in the corner. What is it doing for you? It's just sitting in the corner. Well, it's no good. The same way with that silver. Same thing with our old stuff. What good is it? What are you using it for? What are you using those old things? What am I using those old CDs for? Is it, am I using it to reminisce on all the old things I used to do? Probably. Let's be honest. You know, I used to like that. I used to drink. Listen to that old jazz, blues music, you know. Something always wants to make us hold on to those times that we thought we were in the light. We were actually in the dark, you know. Times were better then. It's a lie. The enemy is telling you a lie. He's telling me a lie. So you have to get rid of that stuff. Had to get rid of it. So, again, they were coveting those things. And Paul says here that no good thing dwells in the flesh. And here we are again. So, let's see. What time is it? 47. All right. So my conclusion is that, you know, as I'm reading this, through verse 13, you know, what is a man? What is, you know, what really is, if I'm walking a young man, you know, and I see all these people, I see all these other men, you know, and I'm trying to discern for myself, you know, I'm new in the Lord. What is a man? What is a man? You know, we all know we got man parts, right? Right? That's easy. But does that make a man? Right? What is a man? What is Joshua? He's this leader, right? So we know Christ is a man. It's the best example we can have. You can turn that PowerPoint on if you don't mind, sir. And so I have some, going to do this. Proverbs 30. And as I begin to look at the biblical definition of what the Bible says about a man, it has some pretty good stuff, real good stuff, actually. Kind of more or less how we describe it. But I think it's good to know what it says biblically, so that way you can know for certain that it's true, right? So let's pull it up. And this is not, again, this is not all-inclusive. It's just some things that I thought were important. And it's got some scriptural reference here. Let's see. Let's see. Did it go away? Let's see. There you go. All right, so this, again, this is my little throw together, and this is a biblical view. And so the first thing, a man would be humble, humility before God, and we acknowledgement of imperfections, of his own imperfections, right? And you find that in Romans 6 and 23. Again, this is not all-inclusive. Right? This is just some of the things that jumped out as I was reading through it. And also controls his appetites. We'll get into that in a second. The other one being the protector of his family and providing for his family and leading his family. So we all kind of know these things. So as a reminder to a lot of us, right? I think it's always good to see it and remind yourself of what it is. And then humility, being self-control, protection, provision, and leadership are the man's responsibility and his tools. Men are accountable for spiritual leadership within their families, and each person is ultimately accountable to God for his or her own life. Right? So again, the children of Ai, Achan, responsible for his own decisions. Right? But these are our tools. And then you have a proper relationship with God, number one. You find that in Micah 6 and 8. Submission to the knowledge of God, relying on God to overcome our temptations, and not twist the scripture in order to get their way or our way or to match our own preferences. Right? A lot of times you hear people talk about the role of the woman in the home, and the Bible says this about, you know, about women. God created men and women equal. Right? We're partners, right? So there's no, you're the leader, but she's not your servant. She's not your slave, basically, right? You are here to protect her. We'll see that in a second. Follow God's commands, Proverbs 1 and 7. Instead of their own urges, some verses here to go with that. Protecting, including laying down your own life, fighting to protect their families. A lot of guys like this one. I will lay down my life for my wife and my family. I wouldn't let anything get in the way of that, you know? That's a good thing. Honor your wife as the weaker vessel. Weaker vessel, before y'all jump to any conclusions, right? Involves something precious, expensive, and valuable. Protecting the spouse and the family from harm, both spiritual and physical, should be a natural instinct for a man of God. Remind yourself of those things. That's a man. It's not somebody playing a man. That's a man. And he was willing to lay down his life. And, you know, and the Bible tells us in Timothy, you know, you don't have to be a brute. You don't have to be aggressive. You don't have to be out there brawling, starting fights and all that kind of carrying on. Nah, that's not a man. That's not a man. You know, Jesus knew that he was going to the cross. He was a man about it. He went about it quietly. Laid his life down for all mankind. Did it quietly. Never said a word. But everybody knew he was about his business. Same thing with us, you know. Be about your business. Be about your family. Stephen said earlier, I got kids, I got to feed them. There you go. Feed them. That's your job. Right? Adam's punishment at the fall was increased pain in his primary responsibility within the family, which was to be a provider. That was his punishment. His increased pain in his primary responsibility within the family, which was to be a provider. God didn't say in the word that the woman was to provide for the family. Forget that. So if you got, I mean, you know, if you got a two family that's working, two people that's working in the home, that's fine. There's nothing wrong with it. If you get laid off or whatever, you know, you can't work or whatever, your wife got people so provided, nothing wrong with that. That's cool. It happens. It happened to me. But that don't mean you lay on your tail end for the rest of your life and not do nothing. You know, that means you gotta find something to do,
right? If it's just wash the dishes and make the bed up, keep the house clean, and the kids fed, you know, that's a job in itself. You got to do something, you know. So
I think I heard Pastor Chuck say a long time ago, you know, I might get it wrong. You can, if you go back, he says, you know, a woman will love you to the end of the earth, rich or poor, as long as she knows that you're going to protect her. Doesn't matter. If you, she knows you're going to protect her and you got it, she's going to follow you to the end of the earth. That's a good thing. I like that. That means I have to always be trying at least to lead my family, you know, at every turn. Even when you don't feel like it, your decision is yours, you know. Your decision is yours. Our fallen nature leads us to resist God's will, even when we don't reject it outright. That's tough. So sometimes we don't want to be the leaders of our families, right? And God says to do that. You know, it says even when we don't reject it outright, you might not say it out of your mouth, but, you know, your body language says a lot about it, right? How you behave, your attitude will show that you're not wanting to be responsible or take responsibility for the protection and the providing of your family. You'll see it. You can see it. I mean, it's you guys are walking with Christ, man. You're going to see people come in the door. You're going to see men here in the church. Once you start maturing and start talking to folks, you'll see, you know, some men just, sometimes, man, they just, you know, don't feel like it, you know, and you have to encourage them. You can't look down on them. You have to encourage them. You can encourage them with these verses and these words, you know, and it's your responsibility as a man in the family to do these things. And there's nothing manly or worthwhile or commendable about a male who shirks responsibilities of his family. This is some heavy stuff. I mean, you know, and it's all scriptural. Then the Bible tells you these things. There's nothing manly about that. Nor is there anything admirable about a society that despises the characteristics of a godly man. So if you got some man or some other family who says, oh, girl, you shouldn't allow him to do that. That's a lie. This is my house. You know, this is my family. Anybody comes here and try to upset this apple cart, they got a problem. This is going smooth. God love this house. You know what I'm saying? So we have family and friends that come to our home all the time. But, you know, don't bring that mess in here. It's a peaceful house. God lives in here. No, none of that nonsense. So, you know. So next week, we'll go ahead and do the other portion. We'll see the battle continue, and we'll see God's correction of that disobedience. But I just wanted to, I don't know why the Lord laid it on my heart to share that with you guys. Because it's important for me also to remind myself, you know, what is a man? What is a man? What does he look like, you know, and how is he supposed to behave, and what's the biblical principle of being a man, and that's what it is. So, and you are responsible for the people that God has entrusted you with, whether you want to be or not, whether they mess up or they don't mess up, either way. And if they do good things, give them credit for that. Don't you take credit for it. Give them credit for it. They do bad things. You take the responsibility. That's the man. That's a man of God. And then, you know, later on, you go to them and say, hey, listen. Okay, next time, we're going to work it out, right? Yeah, we're going to work it out. Okay, I trust you to get that done. It's good for you, right? And that's called empowering, and it's called growth. Because you allow them to grow into that position. If you continually keep your foot on their neck, they'll never grow. They'll grow out from under you and move away, but they'll never grow as a man, right? Okay, I'm gonna stop.